Om Niranjanam Nityam Anantarupam Bhakta Anukampa Dhrita Vigraham Vai Ishavataram Parameshwa Middham Tam Ramakrishnam Shirasa Namami. Very beloved Swami Suvirananda ji Maharaj on the dais, who is the head of our Ramakrishna Mission Vidyapeeth at Chennai. Others on the dais are Dr. M. Jayaraman, whom we have just now listened to, Director Research, Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, Chennai. And then a very renowned speaker indeed. I've heard a lot personally about him, Sri Chakravorty Sullivele, founder Juva Brigade, Bangalore. My very, very beloved brother monks, beloved brahmacharians, and should I say very, very respected devotees and admirers of Sri Ramakrishna, the great master. It's indeed a privilege for all of us to be here about Sri Ramakrishna. We are devotees, and naturally we are perpetually troubled with the question, how to do it? Sri Ramakrishna has told that the goal of life is to know the ultimate. You are that God, and you have to realize that aspect. Sometimes the householders think this is something very much beyond our reach. It is for the sannyasins and sannyasins alone. I am reminded of an incident which I was personally a witness to when I was a student in the university. It was 1st of January. As you know that on 1st of January 1886, Sri Ramakrishna became a wish-yielding tree, Kalpataru. And on this day there was a Dharma Sabha, a public meeting on the life and message of Sri Ramakrishna. By the time I reached, I was slightly late, and then I found the president of the occasion, Swami Gambhirananda ji Maharaj. I am sure if not all of you, many of you have heard about him. Swami Gambhirananda ji was the general secretary of Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission. Then he stood up to deliver his presidential address. There was one on his right side, a Swami, and on his left side there was a householder devotee. Now Gambhirananda ji told in his presidential address, I do still remember something which happened maybe more than 50 years back. He told that the gentleman on my left wanted to establish, as if Sri Ramakrishna came for the householders and householders alone. The Swami on my right wanted to expound as it were Sri Ramakrishna came for the sannyasins and sannyasins alone. What I say is, Sri Ramakrishna came neither for the householders nor for the sannyasins. Sri Ramakrishna came for those who earnestly seek for him. So this is what it is. And such was a soul. You all know, you have heard of him, you have seen his photograph, Professor Mahendranath Gupta. am the recorder of gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. Am came to Sri Ramakrishna sometime in 1882. His first visit to Sri Ramakrishna was on 26th of February 1882. As you know, Am was the principal of a school where even Swami Brahmananda ji was a student. All of them came to Sri Ramakrishna much earlier than Am. Why did Am not come to Sri Ramakrishna earlier is the question. And more important question is, why did he come? Swami Brahmananda ji, Swami Vivekananda and other brother disciples, they came with a question. As you know that Narendra Nath, as a boy of Scottish Church College, had very categorical, very specific question. Sir, is there God? If there is, can it be seen? Have you seen it? If you have seen, can you show me? That was by and large the urge, the spirit which led all these young boys come to Sri Ramakrishna. Mahendranath Gupta didn't come to Sri Ramakrishna exactly from that kind of inspiration. Mahendranath Gupta wanted to commit suicide. I will not get into details because time constraint is there. So, as a sequel of events, it happened that he was in the courtyard of Rani Rashmani's temple at Dakshineshwar. He went to the 12 Shiva Mandir. He went to the temple of Bhavatarini. He went to Ramlala's temple and so on. It was evening just like this. And then he thought that I have heard that there is a saint here, Ramakrishna Paramhansa by name. When I have come here, and as you know that Am was under the stress of a very disturbedly thought like committing suicide. So he thought that fine. Ramakrishna is here, I am told, I have come, let me go and see. That was the first visit of Am to Sri Ramakrishna. Am was a perfect gentleman. Am was the headmaster of famous metropolitan school in Calcutta, a school which was founded by the famous Vidyasagar, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. And also, many of those who came to Sri Ramakrishna later on was studied in that school. Am was brother-in-law of the famous Keshav Chandra Sen. Am's wife was the sister of Keshav Chandra Sen. Am was a name which was familiar to the intelligentsia of Bengal those days. Everybody used to know Am. Such a name, a perfect gentleman. He came, and then he was wondering how to get into his room. And then he found one servant, maid servant. Her name is Brinda. And interestingly, in Bhagavata also you will find there was a maid servant of Lord Krishna whose name was Brinda. Anyway, Brinda was coming out of the room. And then Am stealthily went to her and told, is that sadhu in the room now? Well, yes. Can I get into and meet him? Yes, most welcome. The room is closed, the door is closed. No, it's not closed from inside. It is just closed. You can push and get into. But Am, he is the headmaster. He is the head of the department of five subjects those days in Ripon College in Calcutta, a very prestigious college. Naturally, his sense of courtesy restricted him from getting into somebody's room who is a stranger to him, and he is also equally a stranger to the man he wants to visit. M was vacillating. Then that maid servant was asked by M, I think that sadhu must be doing meditation now. That lady smiled a little and told, meditation? No, I have never seen him doing meditation. But I have seen him getting into trance every moment. He gets into ecstasy, in a very deep ecstasy, in ecstasy of high order, every now and then. But formal meditation, formal rituals, no, I have never seen. I think this saint, this Swami, this sadhu, he must be reading a lot of scriptures. Brinde again smiled and told, reading scriptures? I have never seen him reading a single book. But all the scriptures are in his throat, all the scriptures are in his tongue. An interesting man, a new man. Swamiji told, I give you a new man, a new scripture, and a new religion. So here was the new man. Then with lot of hesitation, with lot of persuasion as well from the maid servant, M made it a point to push the door and get into. M went and did namaskaram as a gentleman meeting another gentleman does. And then Sri Ramakrishna looked at him and he told, committing suicide is a great sacrilege. M says, what kind of man is this? Even an insect doesn't know that I'm going to commit suicide. I have never told it to anybody. And how this man knew that I am going to commit suicide? And then Sri Ramakrishna says, well, you can take leave of me now, come again. M didn't give up the idea of committing suicide. But M was not able to commit suicide either. And then, again, M was feeling attraction to go to this man. The second visit, M has started the process of khandana bhava bandhana. Bandhana is only one thing. I. You have gone to the church. You have seen cross there. I, you cross it and you are Jesus. This is the meaning of the cross. You must cross the I and you become Jesus. Sri Ramakrishna could accost that this man has middle class intellectual ego, which is why Sri Ramakrishna lashed at him at the very second visit. He told, have you got married? He told, yes. And Sri Ramakrishna cried aloud as if some, you know, venomous insect has injected something in his body. He cried aloud. His nephew was Ramlal. So he told Ramlal, this man has got married and M is with his head downcast, was thinking, is doing marriage such a bad thing? And then Sri Ramakrishna asked, okay, but have you children? And he says, again with head downcast, he told, yes, Ramlal, he has got children also. as if everything is lost for him. And then he says, okay, but then how is your wife? Vidyastri or Avidyastri? Then M says, she is ignorant. And Sri Ramakrishna started lashing at him. Oh, she is ignorant. And you think that you are very learned. You have mastered a few secular subjects like logic, philosophy, history, English literature, Bangla literature, and you think that you have become a very learned man. And your wife, having no acquaintance with 3 years, is ignorant. Ya vidya sabimuktaye, sa chaturi chaturi. That kind of intelligence only is intelligence, the intelligence that take you to God. Otherwise, everything else is foolishness. So, aims, khandana bhava bandhana, this process has started. Sri Ramakrishna has amply demonstrated before him that you think you are a big intellectual. You think that you are Keshav's brother-in-law. You think that you are the crest jewel of the crown of intelligentsia of Bengal. So what? You are far away from God. Your learning is no learning. And then, M's ego is being crushed. And that day M went back again. Couldn't commit suicide as yet. And feeling attracted to this man, again he went to Sri Ramakrishna. That was the third visit. Now when he went to Sri Ramakrishna, M writes, if you read Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, what I am speaking about is just the beginning of the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. As you can understand, first visit, second visit, third visit, and so on. Third visit, M himself is writing in the Gospel. What he writes? He writes, my ego has been powdered. By now, my ego has been crushed, powdered. And then M has come. Sri Ramakrishna is sitting in his usual posture in the court. Then there is some conversation going on. And Sri Ramakrishna says, God is without form. After some time, Sri Ramakrishna says, God has form. And M is totally confused, perplexed. This man says just a minute back that God is without form. And then after 1 minute he says, God is with form. How is it? How do you reconciliate between these two opposing statements? M says, you told this and you told this, how do I reconciliate? Sri Ramakrishna again rebuked him. He told, you Calcuttans, you are very much accustomed to giving lecture and lecture. There is no end to the God's entity. God is manifested everywhere in infinite forms. It can be without form, it can be with form. This is Sakara and Nirakara, Saguna Brahma, Nirguna Brahma. But this is the Supreme Being that one can think of. Again, M's ego, the remnant of his ego, is being crushed. And then M says, we are householders. What about us? M, I think, represents that vast multitude. The people who came and went back. The people who came during his time. The people like you who will come during the days to come. M was representative of this eternal question. on behalf of all the householders to come during the years to come in the world and the universe. What was that question? What will happen to the householders? What will householders do? How can householders meet God? And Sri Ramakrishna says very beautifully. He gives three solutions. If you read the Gospel, you will find it. He clearly says, one is association with holy men. Another is solitude. Another is faith, conviction. Now what is this? What do we understand by association with holy men? Does holy men mean that I am putting on gerua, saffron clothes and I am a holy man? No, it can't be. It can't be. I am a holy man. Now when you come to me, you speak to me, do you really feel that you have come in association, in contact with a holy man? You come, you speak out about the society, you speak about little bit about politics going on all around, you speak of all secular matters and go back. So what? You have not done, you might have done many things, but certainly not what you call association with holy men. Now, association with holy men means as simple as that you are in contact psychologically, mentally, intellectually, ultimately maturing into what you call spiritually. The good ideas, holy ideas. So one may very well question that fine, I have got Upanishad, I have got Bhagavad Gita, I have got Bhagavatam, I have got Swamiji's work, I have got Sri Ramakrishna's gospel, I have got many other scriptures, I can sit at home and I can very well go through those and I do have holy association, sitting at home. Is it true? Is it called holy association or holy men's association? No. You are coming across the ideas of what you call great servants, great saints, good ideas, but even then, it doesn't amount to what you call association with a holy man. Why? You may read a lot, but you have to spiritually evolve. Intellectual evolution is necessary, but it must take you to the stage of spiritual evolution. And mere reading scripture cannot take you to spiritual revolution. You cannot evolve spiritually unless you come in contact with gold. Iron doesn't become gold unless it comes in contact with gold. So you have to read, but then you have to come to a holy man. You have to listen all these good words through the mouth of a holy man. Why? Because this holy man, when they speak the same words as we have read in the Upanishads, those words are charged to it, nourished to it, the penance, the fire, the strength that they have earned through spiritual practice. This is why the verse in the Upanishads has to be fortified with the renunciation, dedication and love for God of the holy man. It must come through the mouth of a holy man. Like I will tell you, All of you have seen banyan tree. Is that that? I don't think there is anybody who has not seen banyan tree. Now we know that seeds of banyan tree are responsible for sprouting of another banyan tree. This is as true as 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. But then, you have 1,000 banyan trees, you plant it and find it for yourself whether a single seed sprouts as a plant. No, it won't. Then how it is that we have banyan tree and goes without mention that it is from the seed of a banyan tree that a banyan plant is sprouted? Where do we meet? It has to come through a process. Process is, a bird must eat it, that seed must come through the night soil of the bird, and from that seed only the banyan tree is sprouted. So it is true, whatever is written in the Upanishads, in the Gita, in the scripture is everything true. But if you want to spiritualize itself, if you want to make it your own, then you have to go through a sadhu. And that sadhu will tell you the same thing, but it has altogether a separate dimension. And that's why Sri Ramakrishna says, you must have association with holy men. Second, solitude. So what does solitude mean? Many people do come to me, many people to come to my colleagues in headquarters, they are at Belur Math, that Maharaj, we will go to Mayavati, kindly give me a recommendation later. Only what do you do in Mayavati? No, I go for solitude. Fine, we sometimes recommend, we sometimes regret. But I have the information, then when these people go, they take, you know, mostly old women go. Mostly. They take with them 3-4 mobiles. They will be talking to the entire world sitting at Mayavati. And then she will also ring up her house, some other person, to know the points that she has to frame against her daughter-in-law. Because after coming here, she will pick up quarrel with them. This is no solitude. Solitude is here. It's not in Mayavati. It's not in Uttarkashi. It's not in Rishikesh. It is not in Gangotri or Jamunotri. Solitude is here. You must create an atmosphere inside yourself where you find your chosen ideal and you, there is none in between. Then there is solitude. You feel intense, immense crowd in intense silence in immense crowd. That is the kind of test whether you have acquired the qualification to have solitude, to be in solitude. And then third, Vishwas, faith, conviction. Conviction is everything. Even in the secular world, a child is born. After some reasonable time, mother says to the child, look, he is your father. He doesn't go for DNA test in the laboratory. Not now, not now, till now in India it is not done. I don't think what will happen after 10 years or 20 years. He believes. He lives for this, he dies for this, that this gentleman is my father, and he sacrifices everything of his for the sake of father. Pitari pritima panne priyante sarva devata. So, this is conviction. This conviction is necessary in the spiritual field also. Swami Madhavananda Ji Maharaj, you must know, he is one of our illustrious presidents. Swami Madhavananda Ji was a son of Holy Mother Sarada Devi. Madhavananda Ji used to very often tell a story which I will like to relay again, and then maybe 75 years from now the story was in the Reader Digest. Madhavananda ji liked the story and he used to tell the story very often. Stories like this, that a boat, not boat, ship, anchored ship, it has steamed up, it has a destination, it is floating on the Atlantic Ocean. And then, you know, when the ship was steamed up, it started for the destination, the deck boy slept and fell in the Atlantic Ocean. Then among the crew, there was a conflict. Conflict is to be or not to be. To tell the pilot or not to tell the pilot. One group is telling that the deck boy has fallen, he died. Naturally, we should immediately report to the pilot. Another group tells why should we report to him now? There is no point in disturbing him, bothering him. When we reach the destination, we will tell him. After all, this is Atlantic Ocean. Boy has fallen into it, and boy must have died by now. So by the time they could resolve their conflict, it was quite some time. Ship has traveled for 60 nautical miles. And when the crew members went and told this to the captain, captain told, why you didn't tell me earlier? Then they explained why they didn't tell him earlier. Then captain told the co-pilot, turn the ship and go to the original position where from we disanchored the ship. The ship was taken. All the crew were surprised and shocked that the boy must have died by now. The captain used to like the boy very much. Maybe that because of this captain has lost his mental equilibrium, which is why he must have told that the ship must be taken to the original position. Anyway, captain's order is order. Nobody can dispute. Ship went, and when the ship went to the near the original position, captain cried aloud, look yonder, look yonder, there is something black being seen. My deck boy is struggling to survive. Throw the life-saving device. Life-saving device was thrown. The boy, with the help of that life-saving device, came back to the ship, and then he fell into swoon. And when he swooned, everybody was waiting. After he came back to the normal plane, the captain stealthily went to that boy and whispered in his ear, my boy, why did you struggle to survive? How long would you survive with this small club in your hand in the Atlantic Ocean? The boy says slowly, I knew my captain would come to save me. In our life, our captain is Sri Ramakrishna, Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna. If we believe that he will come to take hold of us at the last moment of our mundane life and take us to the heavenly abode, he will certainly do it. He didn't come only to eat rasagolla and banana. He came to serve those, to save those who are lost or about to be lost. And then I will take another few minutes. Am I permitted to? So another few minutes to conclude or wrap up what I wanted to tell you. Then, you know, the fourth visit, date is not mentioned in the gospel. But then, it was an interesting afternoon. M has come as usual. Narendra and Rakhal and all of them were, you know, singing in his melodious voice. Narendranath was singing. There was absolute silence everywhere. And then Sri Ramakrishna was in Bhava Mukha, means a middle position of Samadhi and Jagriti. Awakening and Samadhi, the middle position is called Bhava Mukha. So Sri Ramakrishna is neither fully unconscious of the mundane world, nor he is fully conscious about this. And then this song, aim came, and song was over. And then Sri Ramakrishna was a master jokesman. He used to crack lot of jokes. Latu Maharaj used to tell Naren Bhai how much of jokes he can crack. Thakur used to crack so much of jokes that we used to giggle and giggle and giggle, and our stomach used to get chuckled. That's what Sri Ramakrishna was. And now Sri Ramakrishna is telling this, everybody is, he is cracking jokes, everybody is smiling, giggling, laughing. But this man, Aim, he has come and sit in a corner and he is grave. And Thakur is telling to his disciple, young disciples, his age is slightly more. He is 27 years old at the time, Aim. That is why he's so grave, he is telling. Anyway, Naren, Rakhal, all of them came out of the room. The master also came out. And in the beginning, he is walking on the courtyard of the Dakshinesha temple. Later on, he shifted himself to the Nath Mandir. Master Moshai waited and then thought that let me ask Thakur whether there will be any more songs today. Which means Master Moshai was totally engrossed. He thoroughly enjoyed this song. He wanted more songs to be sung on that day. So he went, and by now Master Moshai has learned how to prostrate before Sri Ramakrishna. On the first day he did Namaskaram. Now he lies down. He prostrates before Sri Ramakrishna. He prostrated, and then when he got up, he asked Sri Ramakrishna, will there be any more songs today? And Sri Ramakrishna told, after a small pause, no, today there will be no more songs. And then he told, you do one thing. You come to Balaram's house next Sunday. Naren, Rakhal, everyone will come. There will be lot of songs, lot of fun, lot of merriment, lot of joy. Please come. Master Moshai told yes. And then he again touched his feet and took leave of him. But then, you know, by the time he reached the main gate of Dakshineshwar, those who have gone to Dakshineshwar amongst you, you must be knowing the main gate, not far from the main temple. That was a classic dilemma. Classic dilemma. In M. M's personality was divided into three. One was the personality of M, the crest jewel of the crown of Calcutta intelligentsia, a typical representative of the intellectuals of Bengal. And then another aspect of his personality was devotee M, who has given everything at the feet of Sri Ramakrishna. Intellectual Aim, this particular element of his personality is suggesting to Aim that Aim, Balaram Bose is a landlord, there is sentry in his house, and then you never went to Balaram Bose residence, You do not know that sentry, nor the sentry knows you. Suppose you go and the sentry doesn't permit you to be in. You are a renowned professor of Bengal. In Calcutta, in the academic circle, you are a household name. You are the principal of the school of Ishar Chandra Vidyasagar. You are heads of departments of 5 subjects in Ripon College. You are brother-in-law of the world-famous Keshav Chandra Sen. With this background, if you go and then the sentry doesn't allow you in, will you be able to swallow that humiliation? You should not go. Better not to go than to suffer. This is the aim's intellectual personality. And the second personality, Bengalis are usually very expert in imbibing self-conflict and sorting it out. They go in the procession in the morning and come to Belur Math temple in the evening. So anyway, you can see that the second content of M's personality, their M is a great devotee. M has sacrificed everything at the feet of his master. His master is Sri Ramakrishna, the emperor of his heart. His master is Sri Ramakrishna, who is his chosen ideal, his preceptor, the pole star of his life, the be-all and end-all of his life. So that devotee Mahendranath Gupta is asking Mahendranath Gupta. Mahendranath, Sri Ramakrishna is the be-all and end-all of your life. Sri Ramakrishna is the emperor of your heart. Sri Ramakrishna is the pole star of your life. Sri Ramakrishna is your ishta, your guru. And you have promised to him that you would go there. And if you do not go, don't you think, Mahendranath, that you will incur such sacrilege that you will not be allowed even to be in hell, much less heaven? So these are the conflicting elements. One is telling, don't go. If you are humiliated, why do you go? Another is telling, if you do not go, you will be, there will be no space even in hell for you. This is the conflict Amo was suffering from. And the third content is the neutral content. What is that neutral content? Swamiji says that before death, half an hour before death, the neutral content comes to surface. You don't have your willpower. Even if you have willpower, but you cannot exercise it. Your sanskar will speak then. Whatever is your sanskar, that will speak. If you eat radish, you belch radish. So, the neutral gear, the objective element of M's personality. He says that, M, why do you get so upset? There are two dichotomies. There are two suggestions, but it can be very well solved. How? You have not come far away from the temple after all. You are only at the main gate of the temple. Fine. You go to your guru, your preceptor, and you submit everything at his feet, and he will certainly give a solution. M goes back to Bhavatar in his temple. And then at that time, as I have told, Thakur was walking on the Nath Mandir of Bhavatarini temple. There was very dim light, only focusing the face of Mother Bhavatarini. There was little more light in the Nath Mandir. Maybe Thakur was walking to and fro, and that's why. Anyway,
Master Mosai went and seeing Master Mosai, Thakur stopped therein. And it is, are you back again? Then he did again pranam and submitted everything that the conflict he had, he was suffering from at the feet of the Master. And Sri Ramakrishna gave a classic solution, a solution not only to him, a solution to one and all, to me, to you, the people who came and gone back, the people who came during the time of him, people who will be coming during the ages to come, like you and me. What was the solution all about? Sri Ramakrishna told, you do one thing, you go to Balaram's house and mention my name. If you mention my name, someone will come and take you inside. If we extend our imagination, if we contemplate on this, if we meditate on this, can't we think that if we mention his name, not only somebody come and the gate of Balaram Babu will be opened. If we mention his name, always someone will be there to take hold of my hand and take me to him, be it in heaven or for that matter, be it the question of mukti. Which is why Sri Ramakrishna and him, at the very beginning, during these four visits, we find the culmination. We find a man who doesn't have any spiritual mooring, out and out a mundane person, a person having vanity, a person having self-ego, a person having all that matters in the world. And this is how this man Aim starts his spiritual sojourn. And then he meets Sri Ramakrishna, and Sri Ramakrishna stirs the khandana bhava bandhana prakriya right then. His ego is powdered. And then ultimately Sri Ramakrishna gives him the key. This is the key of the treasure house. I am giving this key to you. Unlock this with this key and you will be with me. That is what Sri Ramakrishna says, that mention my name. So we are here this evening, and this is certainly on the occasion of 184th anniversary of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa Dev. Then when do we go home today? Until the next such occasion comes next year, we should have an exercise. And this exercise is Sadhu Sangha, association with holy man, and holy man in the true sense of the term, and then solitude inside here, a firm conviction, and more than that, you must have the conviction, must have the faith, that if you remember him, he will send someone to take you, which is why you have to do the practice of always japam, perpetual japam, perpetual repetition of the name. Somebody will tell why. At that time I will mention his name and he will come. True, he will come. But at that time you will not remember him. Latu Maharaj says, Sri Ramakrishna says, whatever will be the thought, final thought in your mind, that is going to be your destination. Oh, sir, you have told a wonderful thing. Then I will keep a servant. I will not remember you, but I will keep a servant and he will remind me at the end and I will remember you and you will come and take me. Sri Ramakrishna says, no, no, it's not like this. He tells a beautiful story. Story is the story of a grocer shopkeeper. The grocer shopkeeper, he has always, you know, done business and counts coins. And naturally, when his final moment came, as it happens in the Hindu family, there is tulsi tree and also the water, holy water, be it from Godavari or from Jamuna or from Ganga, whatever it is, this is given. And his son, the youngest son, he went, gave this tulsi pata and Ganga jal and all that. And then he is telling in his ear that, "Father, you mention, you remember the name of Hari, you chant the name of Hari." And father doesn't tell anything. He changed sides and keep quiet. Usually youngest sons are slightly afraid of father also. Youngest is very close to mother. Eldest is very close to father, because there is a chance of giving and take, bartering. So father likes the elder son. The middle sons, I pity for them. Neither mother nor father. So anyway, the eldest son, he takes a little liberty with father, which is why he told and spoke loudly in his ear, "Father, chant the name of Hari." And this father says, "I can't tell this big word. You see, the lamp is burning, oil is being wasted, you put out the lamp." And that's how he died. Which is why the neutral gear will work according to your own sanskara. That is why we will make our sanskara like this, where at the last moment, at the final moment, when Sri Ramakrishna comes, Sri Ramakrishna will come to all of us. But if we disappoint him, if we say don't come, wait outside, then he will go back. So when Sri Ramakrishna comes to take me, I must be ready, verbatim and in spirit, to respond to his call. And this is what we have to do. This is spiritual life, nothing short of it, nothing more than that. In spirituality there is no tuktak. I am told there are 760 Bhagavan in India today. But anyway, let the Bhagavan be in their own place. Some are behind the bar, some are doing so many things anyway. But ours is Ramakrishna, who gives us pure spirituality. And he says that you must ultimately take refuge in the Lord. If you do so, if you go four steps, Lord will come forward and then shake hands with you and take you to your cherished abode. So also is our mother, Holy Mother Sarada Devi. She says, when there is darkness all around, when there is none to help you, then know it for certain you have a mother, nor a foster mother, neither a stepmother, a real mother. And we have Thakur, we have mother, and we have Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda says, "Do what I say. If it doesn't beget you heaven, this Vivekananda would come down from heaven and take you with the top of the hill. There is no God, no demon who can stop him on the way." This is why we are very fortunate. He has come with infinite grace to make God realization so easy. If somebody puts his or her energy much less than what he or she does for getting a graduation degree, he or she can reach God. And the purpose of our meeting here is precisely nothing short of marching towards the feet of God, seeing him, talking to him, shaking hands with him, and getting ready for the final moment when we will go with our master. With these few words, I thank you so much for giving me a very, very patient audience for such a long time. And I also must express my gratitude to Swami Vimurtananda ji, the manager of Madras Math, who has given me the wonderful opportunity. And I am also grateful to
Swami Gautamananda Ji Maharaj. I had the privilege of working with him during early years of my monastic life under his stewardship, and we have a very close relation. And he called me last year, but I couldn't really make it. And this year he rang him my pranams, although he is not here, he was to be here today for benediction. My pranam goes to his holy lotus feet, and I wish him a very speedy recovery. Again, I wish you all the best, and I invoke the blessings of Sri Sri Thakur, Ma, and Swamiji Maharaj for well-being of all of us. Thank you so very much.